Thank you, sir. Request on part of FBI. On part of FBI, this is a request to you.
Okay, thank you, sir. My slides are visible?
Yes, yes, visible.
Yes.
No,
so we are going to discuss a combination, basically heart failure and diabetes. Both are multi-system disease. Heart failure is not a disease of heart only. It is a multi-system disease. Diabetes also is not a multi-value. It is also a multi-system disease. So it has got implications all throughout the body. And in internal milieu, there is a change, that is hyperglycemia, insulin resistance, and hyperinsulinemia. Last two words, that is insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia, is the main area where we are much interested, because our most of the cardiovascular complications are related to these two. And regarding cardiac heart failure, that means what is our topic of discussion, can be due to ischemic cardiomyopathy, that means he has sustained an acute coronary syndrome and ultimately lead to myocardial dysfunction that has led to ischemic cardiomyopathy. And we are creating that substrate day by day. That means every SCS we are treating may left over with LV dysfunction. And the continuous ongoing LV remodeling will ultimately lead to severe LV dysfunction with heart failure. That means clinical heart failure. Another thing is hypertensive cardiomyopathy. That means if the diabetes and hypertension are associated. And 95% of diabetes are complicated one. That means they are associated with some other cardiovascular risk factors, like other metabolic disturbances, or there will be hypertension. There may be other organ dysfunctions. And there will be some structural alteration also with time. That means cardiomyocyte hypertrophy. And there is a metabolic disturbances, that means mostly mitochondrial dysfunction and increased oxidative stress. That can lead to diabetic cardiomyopathy and also neurohumoral surge. And there is a correlation that this is related to more of variability of blood sugars, because those who have too much of variability in their glycemic control, their autonomic nervous system will be very much unstable. And this neurohumoral overactivity will lead to fibrosis, that means mostly myocardial fibrosis, and that can lead to either cell loss, that means apoptotic cell loss, and cardiomyocyte hypertrophy, leading to diabetic cardiomyopathy and heart failure. And patients with diabetes mellitus have more than twofold risk of developing heart failure. And most of the patients, those who have hypertension is associated, this become six times more. And diabetes mellitus is an independent risk factor for heart failure related hospitalization. And also micro and macro, both type of vascular complications are more with diabetes if they have cardiac dysfunction. And prevalence of heart failure in diabetes population is four times higher than general population. This is a case example we are going forward, and I will throw some questions to our co-panelists, Dr. Swaycha Chakraborty and Dr. Rajodhari. And Akshay, this is a putative patient, 65-year-old, a retired government officer, diabetes since last 7 years, and he has heart failure with reduced ejection fraction following an acute myocardial infarction, treated with rescue angioplasty, and they are left over with a reduced LV ejection fraction that was around 38%. Since 3 years, now there is ongoing antidiabetic therapy, ongoing heart failure therapy, and ongoing antiplatelet and statin. And regarding diabetic therapy, there is metformin and vildagliptin is ongoing. And regarding heart failure, there is ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, and mineralocorticoid antagonist. However, recently complaints of difficulty in breathing, tiredness, and swelling over the feet. As per patient version, I like morning walks with my colleagues. Since last week, I am skipping my morning walks and facing difficulty in exercising too. That means he's symptomatically getting deteriorated. On clinical examination, HbA1c is 7%, NT-proBNP is 1642 picogram per ml. Creatinine is 1.13 with eGFR around 70. Blood pressure is 120/80. Ejection fraction is 24% now. Because of LV rebonding, it has deteriorated. And fasting blood sugar is 120. Based on clinical examination, current therapy with ACE inhibitor and ARB is not showing clinical improvement. Now I will ask my one colleague, that is co-speaker, that is Dr. Shekhar Chakraborty, is an eminent physician in North Bengal. And he is doing a lot of job during this COVID time also. Do you feel that OXO is at increased risk of mortality? Dr. Chakraborty?
Shekhar sir, ekto unmute kore nin, apni mute achen.
Shekhar, unmute yourself.
Yes. Yes, yes. Am I audible to you?
Yes.
Yes. Start on.
Yes. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mondal, for your wonderful presentation of the case and rolling the case for different aspects and its analysis. Now, it is obvious that the heart failure and diabetes has got a combined incidence and prevalence. And since 1991, there are a lot of trials have been conducted, like SOLVE, CHARM, MEDIT-HF, SHIFT, EMPHASIS-HF, PARADIGM SHIFT, DAPA, VICTORIA, and EMPEROR RED in 2020, all have shown that in chronic heart failure, the prevalence of the diabetes is around 40%. So therefore, a good combination of heart failure and diabetes already prevails. Next one. So mortality remains high in the diabetic patients, particularly having the reduced ejection fraction. This study has been published in Heart Failure in 2016 by Carstensen, and his team has shown that there is 64% increase in risk of cardiovascular death and hospitalization for the heart failure in patients with diabetes with a reduced ejection fraction. And also, if we consider that there is 54% reductions of the cardiovascular death, it is also shown that there is 90% increase in the risk of heart failure for hospitalization of patients having diabetes and reduced ejection fraction. There is also all-cause mortality is increased by 46% in the patients with diabetes and having reduced ejection fraction. So with this trial, it is obvious that there is increased mortality due to heart failure in diabetic cohorts.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Chakraborty. Another thing I would like to add, this now there is a connotation that our previous speaker has also told from diabetic side, that diabetic not triad, it is pentad. That is one thing. Yes. That the variability of blood sugar is most important, particularly in this group of patients, where there is autonomic variability, chance of sudden cardiac death increases, particularly with nocturnal hypoglycemia. If there is too much of hypoglycemia, there will be QT prolongation during that phase, and that can invite ventricular arrhythmia, and that can be lethal. At least one third of death in diabetes and heart failure, particularly with reduced ejection fraction, is sudden, that means sudden cardiac death. And there is a strong correlation with hypoglycemic episodes. That's why this diabetic pentad is a really, really a good thought. And we have to prevent the nocturnal hypoglycemia that increases the sudden cardiac death rate.
Yes.
Now, the second question is, what is the treatment approach in patients with diabetes and reduced ejection fraction? Should we stay on ACE inhibitor ARB, or we should switch to ARNI and switch to SGLT2 inhibitor? And Dr. Rai Choudhury, please comment.
I I would rather combine both ARNI and SGLT2 inhibitors.
That's a good thought. I think that is the most scientific thought now. We'll show some evidences. Dr. Rajadri should go on commenting. So option A is definitely correct. And we should combine both B and C. That means switch to ARNI and try to introduce SGLT2 inhibitor. And what is the treatment approach in patients with diabetes with reduced ejection fraction? Now then, mortality remains high in patients with diabetes and heart failure, even with good control of diabetes, with even with insulin. That's the real challenge. And what should be the approach like this? And mortality, even after ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, mineralocorticoid antagonist, ARB, all remained high. Though they are thought to be disease-modifying agent, like in rheumatology, the disease-modifying agent, here these are also taken as disease-modifying agent, particularly ACE inhibitor, beta blocker, mineralocorticoid antagonist, ARB, all has got some role. And also evapridine is now to be proved to be also a disease modifier. But even after that, at least 16 to 34%, there is a range between agents, but there is a, this kind of patients remain symptomatic, though their mortality remains same, like well-controlled or uncontrolled diabetes. Need for better therapy in patients with diabetes with reduced ejection fraction is definitely a real challenge now. Switch to ARNI, evidences, I think Dr. Chakraborty, you can continue that. What are the evidences that direct ARNI approach is now recommended? That means if a patient is having heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, though there may not be a clinical event, that patient has not developed any CCA, not developed any acute LVF. Whenever there is a reduced ejection fraction, suppose 42%, 45%, or 35%, we can directly start ARNI. That approach is also given by ACC expert consensus in March 2021. ARNI has an expanded role focused on optimizing therapy for heart failure. Superior benefits, rapid improvement, and cardiac reverse remodeling. That is the main area. And also, SGLT2 inhibitor, they have got a strong role. I will request Dr. Roy Chaudhary to comment on this regarding SGLT2 inhibitor add-on therapy, because I'm a cardiologist. Our job of implanting devices, particularly CRT devices, is going, number is going down day by day. What I have done in 2019, in 2020, it has come down, and 2021, it is also coming down because of introduction of these two novel group of drugs. I will request Dr. Roy Chaudhary to comment on this.
The ACC 2021 consensus recommends that SGLT2 inhibitors are added as a part of therapy for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction patients who are already receiving ARNI, beta blockers, and aldosterone antagonists. This was particularly powered by the DAPA heart failure study, where we saw that there was enormous benefit both in patients with diabetes as well as with diabetes. Sacubitril and valsartan improves the clinical outcomes in patients with diabetes and heart failure, reduced ejection fraction. If you can look at this forest plot, and the yellow dots are all to the left side of the unity line, which favors the sacubitril valsartan. Whether the glycemic status is diabetes or undiagnosed diabetes or pre-diabetes or even in normoglycemic subjects, if you look at the p-value for interaction, it is significant at 0.13. And if you look at all the upper bound of the confidence interval of the hazard ratios, all except that in undiagnosed diabetes, that is less than one. So that's significant, and it is more preferred. So sacubitril valsartan scores over enalapril, which was used in a dosage of 10 milligram twice daily in the paradigm heart failure study. There's a 20% risk reduction in CV death with sacubitril valsartan, and also in risk of heart failure hospitalization as compared to enalapril.
No, Now I will request you again to comment on, does NT-proBNP play a major role in prognosticating heart failure?
Yeah, NT-proBNP, before going into NT-proBNP, let us look at the increase in risk of heart failure in type 2 diabetes patients. It's about 1 in 3 patients, 29.3%. Then let's look at patients with diabetes and heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. They have a 3.35 times increase in the risk of cardiovascular death and heart failure hospitalization. And once you look into increased risk of all-cause mortality in patients with diabetes and heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, it numbers up to 3.34 times. And NT-proBNP concentrations holds a pivotal role in evaluation of the overall status. Thus, NT-proBNP would facilitate the establishment of correct management. Next slide, please.
Definitely, because I will comment one thing here, that is re-heart hospitalization following heart failure. That means there is a heart failure admission, we are discharging. If there is a readmission, chance of death increases at least 1.6 times. And that may be on the way to back to hospital or after reaching emergency or maybe sudden death. So here, NT-proBNP after clinical stabilization, suppose your S3 has gone, no pulmonary, no edema, no hepatomegaly, JVP is normal. But now what will be the parameter to discharge that patient? Is the patient is well dried? Is stable? NT-proBNP is definitely a good marker. If it becomes normal, then chance of rehospitalization will be less. Another question to Dr. Roy Choudhury again. What is the impact of sacubitril valsartan on glycemic control and use of insulin in patients with diabetes and heart failure with reduced ejection fraction?
Could I have a slide, please?
Do you change your strategy after introduction of ARNI?
After ARNI, we really have to see that HbA1c concentration, then it has been shown that 0.14% greater in between group reduction in HbA1c concentration over 3 years with sacubitril valsartan. So as these patients are very often having a compromised renal function also, the modification of insulin dosage is on the cards once you start the ARNI, because ARNI and improvement of heart failure has been seen to have a beneficial effect on the HbA1c reduction. And there is a 29% reduction in new use of insulin with sacubitril valsartan as compared to enalapril in the PARADIGM heart failure study. And patients, as the one whom we have discussed, if they are started on oral anti-hyperglycemic therapy, there is a 30% reduction in the risk of introduction of insulin. And also there's a possibility that you will gain a certain amount of HbA1c reduction on introduction of ARNI.
This is the last question. Is there any evidence of sacubitril valsartan in Indian patient with heart failure with reduced ejection fraction? I'll request Dr. Chakraborty to make comment on this Indian experience.
Yes, well, you see that we always think that the India is ethnically, culturally, and genetically a different cohort, which is being compared with the other cohorts as well. Now, when the paradigm shift HF trial has been conducted, there was an Indian cohort has been included with it. And there is evidence, and this cohort has been analyzed, but the evidence of whether sacubitril valsartan in the patients of the diabetes and reduced ejection fractions are same applicable to what is the global benefit has been obtained or not. And now it has been observed that when compared to the CV death and heart failure hospitalization, then it is 11% reductions in the risk of CV death and heart failure hospitalization in reduced ejection fraction cohort, but in Indian subjects. If we consider in the CV death as well, there is 13% reductions in the risk of CV death in heart failure. And also, if the first heart failure hospitalization is considered, there is almost 22% reductions in the Indian subjects. So therefore, its all-cause mortality also reduced by 12% in compared to in sacubactril valsartan group compared to the enalapril group. So there is clear-cut evidence that the there is comparison between a global...
Please turn down the program.
This.
There is a comparison.
So all, if we after this discussion, we can conclude after particularly in Indian patients where we are, our dyslipidemia is diabetic-like diabetic patients. Ethnically, we are insulin resistant. Ethnically, we have more LPA. Ethnically, we have low HDL. We have more of acute presentations of atherosclerotic vascular disease. We have more fragile blood sugar control level, and we have autonomic instability more. Considering this, that the ethnic variability, all these discussions and paradigm heart failure, Indian cohort, they have proved that sacubactril valsartan reduces the risk of mortality and improves quality of life with diabetes and heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. And they also reduce the mortality more conclusively in Indians. And patients with diabetes should be recommended as the first line therapy is sacubactril valsartan. If the ejection fraction is low, less than 45%, straightforward, we are prescribing this ARNI to these patients because this group of patients after MI or an AC, other group ACS or ansible angina or NSTEMI, they will come back after a few months or years with clinical evidence of heart failure because of remodeling of LV.
So and also Dr. Yes. Mondal, please mention that the quality of the life is also improved.
Yes.
This is very important.
And because both these are in one word, diabetes and heart failure, both are depleter of nutrients to cells and nutrients, that means oxygen to cells. That means diabetic patients, their cells are starving. Heart failure patients, their cells are starving. That means to cardiologists, heart muscles are in a starved state. Heart muscles are in a starved state, both in heart failure and diabetes.
Few questions are invited.
If there is any questions, if time permits, we can answer, no problem.
No, I think there is no time, Prakash. Since we're at the end of the program, thank you, Prakash.